You're listening to a bonus episode of the Jurassic Park podcast. Enjoy.
Where's Aunt Claire?
7 o'clock tomorrow night on the East Dock. Make sure he gets it right.
But it's alive! And everyone on the planet's going to line up to appreciate it and everything done.
People would say they could see the fleas. Oh, I could see the fleas. Mommy, can't you see the fleas?
Are these characters auto-erotic?
No, no, no.
Come on!
Hello, everybody, and welcome to a bonus episode of the Jurassic Park podcast. I am your host, as always, Brad Jost, and today we're going to do a little bit something special. I have a few different voicemails here from Fede. They've been sitting in our inbox for a little while, and he originally sent them in, and we were going to cover them in the mailbag, but since Jen doesn't really have a huge wealth of knowledge on the scores and the soundtracks, I kind of just decided to tackle this by myself. I was looking to put it in an episode coming up, but you know what? I felt like it's been long enough, so why don't we just get this these played on here and stop wasting time, you know, because he's got some good questions in here, some good thoughts, and I really wanted to get them out there. There are a few different ones, and some of them are a little bit, not, you know, a few minutes long, not too bad. But we're going to play some music. We're going to listen to what he has to say. I'm going to try to comment as best as I can, follow up on some of those things, because like I said, they've been in here for a little while, so it dates back to some of the stuff we talked about on one of the previous mailbags. I forget which one specifically. Sorry, Fede, it's been a while. I know. My fault. But today we're going to get into it, and I'm glad to bring it to you guys. So if you guys want to follow him, first off, he is at OwenPratt93 on Twitter. Go follow him. Hear what he has to say on there, and now let's take a listen to what he has to say here on the podcast.
Hi, Brad, and hi, Jen, if Jen is there too.
Nope, she's not here.
I wanted to thank you for mentioning me in the other podcast about the film score. When Brad said, oh, we should talk with someone about film score, but who we can find to talk about it. And I was thinking, oh, well, it will be so interesting to talk about it. I will do it. And then Jen said, oh, yeah, that Fede guy. And I was like, oh, she said my name. So, yeah, and Brad mentioned that for a problem of time zones, seems I'm here in Italy. And also, I'm sorry for my English, which is kind of poor. It's like, I realize maybe it will... a bit like you know, like Bayona when he talks, you understand that is not English, it's Spanish, it talks in this way, so I like him, but a bit worse, since I don't know all the terms. Anyway,
hold on, Fede, have you listened to the mailbag before? I don't know all the terms either. I'm constantly messing everything up, but let's get back into it.
I wanted to talk about the score, and I will send you maybe more than one voicemail, because I think
you gonna check
will be too long to listen in just one voicemail, and I don't want to annoy people who's listening.
Oh no, we're going to annoy everybody. We're playing all three right now. Let's do it, dude.
So, first thing is about the Jurassic World suite by Michael Giacchino at the 50th birthday concert in London. So, you, Brad, said, I actually didn't expect that you wouldn't like the suite. I mean, I guess you kind of liked it, but you were also disappointed by it. I loved it, but I can see where it came from. I mean, there's that transition you talked about between the what they call the family theme to the park theme, the main theme of Jurassic World, which is beautiful. And yeah, there's like that tempo problem. There's the piano that is like running, is really fast. The rest is perfect to me. Yes, there was that strange, awkward moment of the T-Rex. That was actually a beautiful idea. Like these posters, these new Blu-ray posters for the Jurassic Park trilogy. Like, they were great ideas to me, but poorly executed. And same here. You know, you see the finale of the suite with this T-Rex roaring on the helipad, you know. But it was the wrong time. It finished 10 seconds before the end of the suite. So yeah, it was like a strange moment, but still, I think the suite was awesome. Another thing, for example, as the Jurassic World turns.
Let's pause it there. If you guys don't remember, a bunch of episodes back in the mailbag, I forget if somebody brought it up or I mentioned it to Jen, but Michael Giacchino had celebrated his 50th birthday, and at this concert that they held, there was a conductor performing a lot of like Michael Giacchino's work from different movies. And they got to Jurassic World. They played like a really nice suite of different, you know, arrangements and everything. And they got to Nine to Survival Job, and they were playing that track. And then, like he said in this voicemail, that there's that transition between the family theme and then like the park slash island theme of Jurassic World, and there's this like piano motif in the middle there that kind of just wanders slowly and softly in the actual score. And I brought both of them up here so we can take a listen and compare the two. So the first one, well, you know what, why don't we play the original one first? We'll try that one just so you can kind of hear what that transition is. So let me see if I can bring it up, find it here. Just give me 1 second. So it's, here's the music. So this is the beginning, but oh, I love this. I love this song so much. But back in the, or at the end of the song, sorry, I'm wandering here. I'm trying to figure this out. It's around here. Nope, too far. Yeah, so right here. Keep going. Okay, so this transition, right here. You hear how slow that is? Dun, 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 dun. It's kind of like... very slow. Dun, 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 dun. So... you get this lead in here, and then it goes into the full orchestra. So you know how that goes. So let's check out the live performance now. This is brought up from Sunny Bell's YouTube. So we played this one before, I think, on the podcast. So let's check out that transition here. It's normal still, but then here it is, right here. You hear how fast he's playing that? Did-a-dun, 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 did-a-dun. It's much faster instead of dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun. Sorry for my rambling music playing with my mouth, but that's the best I could do for this moment. I don't have my piano out. It's over there. But so you get what I'm saying here is this live performance was like double time. They just doubled down. It was like dun-dun, 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 instead of that dun-dun, 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 dun-dun. So it just was way more relaxed on the original score. So I don't know what happened here. The conductor is conducting in that faster pace. So I think it's on him, to be honest. Or maybe because I know when they perform to a screen or something like that, there's usually like you know, a bar or something in front of them that's kind of, you know, transpiring as the song is going on so that they can stay in tempo with what's on the screen. So I don't know what happened, but something happened because when it got to the end of the song, it played out exactly the way it does in the movie where the T-Rex is wandering up on top of the building and just roars and all that stuff. But when the screen like goes black and all that, the music was still going and it just didn't work out right. It just kind of looked silly. And I watched a bunch of the other performances and everything else was like spot on. Everything sounded fantastic. But for some reason that just messed up there. But aside from that moment, I did really like what they did here. It does sound really good. The quality is great, except for that moment. It just bugged me. But I know I'm weird, but let's get back into his voicemail here.
I love that track, of course, but in the suite it felt even better to me, because like the sound of the trumpets, I actually love the score, of course, of Michael Giacchino, but I think problem with the score, if I had to find the problem and be and being nitpicky, is that unlike John Williams' score, which is of course great composition, but also the sound of it is beautiful and natural, Michael Giacchino's score sometimes feel a bit artificial. I think it's not Giacchino's score fault, but it's maybe the sound designer's fault, I guess, or the sound mixing or something like that. Like the trumpets feel like too artificial in some points, especially in as the Jurassic World turns, while in the suite, of course, because it's played by an orchestra in live, so that sounds much more natural, and I loved it. I loved also how they used the first theme, the Indominus theme. This is a fantastic theme.
Oh yeah,
it sounds
there it
so
is.
Ominous. And the only thing I disliked about those little flows that you mentioned is that they didn't put there the Ingen's theme or Hoskins' theme, which is, I think, is absolutely fantastic theme.
Okay, I'm gonna pause it right there because I want to touch on that bit where he mentioned it sounding not fake, but like inauthentic or something like that. It didn't sound as good as the Jurassic Park one. And I get it. I actually really get his point here. Because when I first heard the Jurassic World score, I almost thought that same thing. It didn't feel as real, almost as if it was synth based or something like that, like it was played with a keyboard or created in the computer. Some of those higher you know, trumpets and whatnot, the brass, they all sounded a little fake to me at first. But I don't know, that notion just kind of drifted away. You can hear it, listen to them. I don't know if it's the fact that, you know, over the years, the recording quality has certainly changed. It doesn't sound as raw and natural. Like, with the Jurassic Park score, you can feel that score. You feel it. You can hear, like, the room. You can hear them recording it, essentially. You can hear people shuffling papers and you know, almost like like clearing throats and all that stuff in the background. It's so real. This one, I thought it didn't have a lot of those moments either, but after listening to it very carefully, and certainly with headphones, you can pick out moments like that more. But I grew to appreciate this score a lot more. So I get what you're saying there, that it sounds a little fakeish at times, but I don't know. I think it's just the day that we live in. You know, things are a little bit different now. Yeah, I've got no explanation for that. Maybe somebody else who has a better knowledge of the recording process and the way things are done today could give a little insight, but that's not me. And then you brought up the InGen theme. That thing, yeah, that is a great theme, man. And it does stink that they, you know, they didn't bring it up here in the show. But if you listen to, like, Pavane for a Dead Apatosaurus, around the, like, 3.5 minute mark, we get this awesome, like, very retro, sounds like the 60s or 70s, like a Henry Mancini or Lalo Schifrin or something like that. Like, I don't know what it is. It just sounds like an adventure theme from, like, the 60s. I don't know. I love it so much. You know, I don't know why. It really gives me like a Johnny Quest vibe or something. You guys remember that like old cartoon? I don't know why, but it I feel like it gives me that kind of vibe. I could be completely wrong, but let's jump back into his voicemail here.
Theme, and it really really feels like a military march.
Oh yeah.
But it's also there's also some kind of evil in there. And it's absolutely fantastic to me. And another thing, the last thing for this long, long message is that I don't know if you ever noticed, but I noticed that the Indians theme and the Raptor or Owens theme has like this the same chords, I don't know how to say it.
Chords, yeah. Same, you got there.
Identical. But the one feels like more militarized, and the other one seems like wild. I think it, but it's the same chords progression. So I think that's an interesting choice by Michael Giacchino. It's like the two sides of the same coin. Now,
yeah, man,
this voicemail is way too long, but maybe I do my apologize, but I wanted to be the a guest in your. In your podcast, so I can't because of the time zone problem. Maybe one day we will manage to fix this, but I will send you this long voicemail, so I think it's a temporary solution to that. And thank you very much. I will maybe send you other voicemails, hopefully a bit shorter, because I think the listeners are already annoyed. See you, and thank you.
Dude, no, nobody's annoyed. Come on, it's fine. And you wanted to be a guest, but guess what? I'm like giving you this whole bonus episode here, since it is tough, man. I feel really bad. We got to do this sometime and actually record together. But yeah, like you said, in Italy, it's like, oh, I don't know how to make this work. Sometimes it's tough making it work with like our contributors out in the UK and stuff like that. It's always tough. We have to figure out a special time to record, which is very rare. So everybody's like off doing their own thing. So, and it's funny because like half the time I don't even record with most of the people on this podcast. So I'm still like finding people that I've never recorded with, you know, before. So this is a first for me and you. So like you said here about like Owen's theme and the InGen theme, that yeah, they definitely do have that same vibe. Like here's Chasing the Dragons. You guys know this. It's very similar to that, what he just said, that that march, but it's not march like. It's more aggressive and it's more like in your face. And yeah, as we get on here, let's see. So right here, this moment, it does sound a lot like that InGen theme, but faster or something like that, right? Something, yeah, you're right. It is something wild about it. Something adventurous for sure. I mean, I described the other one as adventurous too, but this one's adventurous in like, a very upbeat way, a very, you know, like the good guy way. The other one is not so much. Let me try to find that one again. That was in this track here. So here it is. Hopefully you can hear all this stuff, all right? Dun 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 dun. So yeah, it is very similar. But this one's like a little bit slower or more relaxed and march-like. Obviously the snare drums in the back and the bass drums and all that. And the crashing cymbals, it's very march-like. And that's because it's militaristic. And we see the military, the InGen military, essentially coming on to the island at these moments and just doing their own business. And Owen is also militaristic in a way, but he's more wild and doing his own thing. So that's a very awesome point that you brought up, and I'm kind of impressed that I was able to sing that Chasing the Dragons and listen to that one at the same time. Wow, giving myself a hand. So stupid. All right, so let's take a listen to your second voicemail.
Hi, Brad.
Hey, Fede.
My second question is a really brief question this time. I wanted to ask you, what do you think about the Jurassic Park 3? Score, because I think it's really, really underrated. Just because it's not John Williams or Michael Giacchino, then everyone seems like to snap that score. But I think it's really great. I mean, it doesn't have the great themes of Jurassic Park or The Lost World or Jurassic World, but still it has the feel of a Jurassic Park movie, in my opinion. It really It really is beautiful to me, that score. I re-listened to that score recently, and wow, I was surprised, I was shocked at how good it was. Just like, think about the beginning, the very beginning of the movie, when there's the logo, Universal logo. That music is scary, is great to me. And I wanted to ask you what you think about the Jurassic Park 3 score, because like it's like no one ever talk about it. And second thing, what is your favorite Jurassic World theme by Michael Giacchino? Just my curiosity. Thank you.
All right, man. So Jurassic Park 3, I mean, I've talked about it a little bit here and there. It's probably been a while since I really heavily touched upon this score, but I do like it, but big caveat there, because I don't love it. And I describe it this way because I think it's the best way to describe it, is that Don Davis felt like he was trying to copy John Williams and try to replicate him a little too much. He didn't necessarily create his own path as much as I would have liked. The times that he did create his own path, I absolutely love. I have a few tracks here queued up. So let's take a listen, because this one is probably my favorite. Well, this first one you hear is the track that you just mentioned under the very beginning of the movie. It's very ominous, but going back to that beginning, I do want to touch on this before I get into my picks here. This moment. I never really loved this sound. Sort of like you said for Jurassic World, it always kind of sounded fake to me or something like that. I don't know how to describe it, but it just didn't feel right. Something about this, actually the intro of this movie in general, doesn't really feel right to me always. Whether it's the restricted font choice or the green screen or whatever, you know, they used for the flying of the, what do you call that thing? A pterosaur, blah, 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 whatever it is, the paraglider. And then this score, it just, this part didn't really sound authentic to me. But throughout the movie, there are several moments that feel truly authentic, like Nash calling. This one is awesome. So good. I really, really love this track. It is one of my favorites. This is John, or not, not John, Don Davis, doing what he does best, is creating like his own version instead of just copying John Williams. Like he does throughout the rest of the score. This one is like basic, it's Nash calling. So at this point in the movie, the cell phone is ringing, or they're getting to that point where it rings in the stomach of the Spinosaurus. So they think it's Nash calling or something like that. But they get to this point where they hear that phone ringing, and they're running through the forest, and they're trying to find each other because they've been separated. And you know, Grant's with Eric, and the Kirbys are together with Billy, and let's fast forward to here so we can get to this part. But they hear that phone ring, and then they all start running to each other. It's like a family celebration. This part, I love this part so much. It has that Jurassic feel, like you said, but it's new. It's something different. You get this family dynamic theme here. Oh, it's so good. I love this one so much. This is adventurous. Feels like family. I don't know. Don Davis really hit the nail on the head with this one. It's so perfect for me. I don't know how to describe it, what it feels like to me, but I don't know if it's like got that 90s vibe, because a lot of scores for me in the 90s, you know, there are family movies and kids movies and stuff like that, and this has that vibe to it. Very 90s feeling, even though this was, you know, a 2001 movie. it just has that feeling for me. And I don't feel like we get a lot of scores like that anymore, actually. Not even Jurassic World. It doesn't even capture that 90s vibe. Recently, Ready Player One came out, and that score has that 90s vibe. Probably on purpose, because it's trying to capture nostalgia and all that. And Alan Silvestri created a lot of, or, you know, kind of recreated a lot of the past and stuff like that. So maybe that's why it kind of has a familiar vibe. But yeah, so that's one of my picks. Actually, this next one here, Bone Man Ben. This is very original and different. Something very different. It's, again, kind of adventurous. It's you can feel them like traversing or doing something. You can hear and feel this music all at the same time. I love it. And it's so different, right? It doesn't really sound like much. There's maybe a moment in Jurassic Park that sounds somewhat similar, like when they're, I think, in the Jeeps, maybe going back to the visitor center. Kind of has a vibe like that, maybe. But it's just, it is a good track. That one I do like a lot. And then you asked also, what is my favorite cue from, or theme from Jurassic World? And I mean, we just talked about this one, but 9 to Survival Job. Just listen to how it starts. It's so beautiful, right? I don't know. I love this one so, so much. More than any of the other moments on the score. I used to like, kind of put Chasing the Dragons on top because it was adventurous and fun and all that stuff. But then I kind of started to love this one a lot more and a lot. It's not even anywhere close anymore. It encompasses so much of the score. It's got this family theme. And that, you know, obviously these movies are all about family. And, this is one of the best moments for me. And it's at the end of the movie, so all the family is coming together at the end. Everybody's safe in the hangar or wherever they are at the end of that movie, with everybody's like getting, fixed up from their injuries and all that. Everybody's kind of sleeping on cots. And Zach and Gray's parents show up, and the family's like reunited, and Claire and Owen are together at this point, and maybe that's short-lived depending on what we see next in Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom, but still, it's everybody's coming together, and it's a good feeling. It's happy, and you get this really slow transition. I love this. Much better than the live version. And this is, they're kind of talking about what they're going to do. They're going to have to stick together for survival and all that. And then eventually we kind of transition to like wide shots of the island and just seeing kind of the island in collapse at this point, and the T-Rex. Oh, it's so, so good. And it, you hear the Rex come into this music too, right? You hear the footsteps right here, and it's just like the tambourine and all that. Oh, it's so good. I love it. And then as you're analyzing this music, you're like, there is nothing else that this song could do except be at the end of a movie with this kind of ending, right? So triumphant. So good. You can hear the Rex roaring. Like, it's not happening, but you can hear it. And you can see the movie end. It just perfectly describes that movie in a nutshell. It's so good. And we're going to talk about endings in a little bit, but I do want to get back to his voicemails, so might as well play. What is this? Why is there static? Hello? What is happening? Why is this always happening to me?
Brad, are you there?
Yeah.
I'm
here.
Oh,
who is this?
Gosh.
Tom?
don't really know how much I can say right now, but there is something really big going on Twitter at the moment. There's a lot of different teases, and they appear to be for some kind of Jurassic-related music project for the Jurassic Park 25th anniversary. I'm not entirely sure how much I can share, but I know there's loads and loads of cool stuff going on behind the scenes, and it looks like it's going to be something really, really cool. I don't know if you've heard anything about it or not, but it might be worth touching on it. It looks like it's going to be epic. I'd advise people to stay tuned to Twitter, and, oh God,
Tom.
Come on, work!
Whoa,
oh
Tom.
Man, no, I'm losing the signal, bro!
Tom, what are you doing? Wait, where'd you go, dude? Hey, man! You interrupt like that and then just fade away. All right, I guess I'm here by myself. Talking to myself. That's, you know, chaos. Guys, I don't know what is going on, but my feed keeps getting interrupted week after week. Every time I do a mailbag type segment, somebody's cutting in. Tom, Victoria, you guys. What is up with your feeds? You're just crossing the signals. But Tom, what were you talking about? You were talking about some awesome stuff going on Twitter right now. Some teasing of some cool projects. Maybe having to do with music. I've seen a lot of images and I've shared some of them with music notes. It looks like a fossil of a music note. There was one that maybe looked like it was like in amber or something like that, or an infinity stone, I think. But I'm getting some good vibes here, guys. There's a few guys sharing this. So keep your eye out. It's going to be an awesome project. If you head on the Twitter, look out for Daryl Lane. You can also find Caleb Burnett and Tom Fishenden. He's out there. That guy's out there apparently, you know, hijacking feeds and whatnot. Find these guys. See what they're up to. They got some stuff going on. Some stuff's brewing. But yeah, so I don't know what it's about. Or maybe I have some ideas, but I'm not going to give them away here. So you're just going to have to wait and find out. But we do have more. Like I was trying to say before Tom cut in, we have another voicemail here from Fede. This is his last one, so he's not going to annoy you guys anymore. This is it. This is the last one, so let's take a listen.
Hi, Brad. Very last question. And what do you expect from the Fallen Kingdom score, especially given Bayona's previous film? Because, he used Fernando Velázquez to compose his previous film scores, and it was very emotional. They were very emotional scores. So do you think Michael Giacchino's score for Fallen Kingdom will be also very emotional, and also because of, you know, the volcano fury and the destruction of Fallen Kingdom, you know, so it might have the chance to be very emotional. What do you think about this? And the very last thing, do you think this theme, this version of the theme of the main Jurassic Park theme, could be used in Fallen Kingdom, this one?
Jurassic Park, scary in the dark. I'm so scared that I'll be eaten.
Okay, this might be used in Fallen Kingdom. Thank you very much.
I hope that's used, man. I could just see him. You know, he's sitting in that courtroom and they're quizzing him. You know, they're like, hey man, what do you think? What's going on with this island? What should we do? Should we destroy all these dinosaurs? Should we save them? And then he just starts singing that. That would be perfect, right? I mean, there's no other way that movie should go, obviously. But what you're hearing underneath this, hopefully, as long as everything's going smoothly, is the main title from The Impossible, which is a super emotional movie from Bayona, Fernando Velázquez, and also it speaks to that movie. I've seen the movie. It's super emotional, like I said, and you know, Bayona has a trend of being very emotional and scary and all this stuff. So how much of this is going to transfer over, you know, how much of his vision will transfer over from a script written by Colin Trevorrow and Derek Connolly? Will it be his own vision or will it be conformed to what they've already created? From what we've seen, it it seems very Jurassic World-like. There's a few moments where it certainly looks terrifying. So I don't know. I think it's going to look Jurassic World, but be infused with, you know, a lot of Bayona's qualities. As far as the scores go, I mean, we obviously have a different composer, Michael Giacchino, and I don't know. I mean, he creates some really emotional stuff. That Nine to Survival Job track is very emotional for me. I just love it. Obviously, I was just speaking very highly of it. But this, listen to this, it's so emotional. And it's perfect for that movie. Will this work, this kind of music work in Fallen Kingdom? Maybe. I could see something like this for, you know, the destruction of the island. And I've always kind of said that with a lot of people on the podcast and on a lot of episodes is that I feel like, you know, if you're going to show Nublar being destroyed, it should be not bombastic or crazy or, you know, all that stuff I talked about with Don Davis and how much he copied John Williams. I feel like it should be emotional and soft and kind of the inverse of what you would think would happen with a moment like that. I think that would be the most impactful for me, and especially very sad because it's a place we've seen for so many years now, and obviously only two films, but we still have that connection with it, you know, for the past 25 years. And it would be very somber and sad, and just seeing it be destroyed like that. And just from the moments in the trailer, I've already been sad seeing all that stuff go down and the deaths of all these dinosaurs and stuff. It's very emotional. So I hope that Michael Giacchino uses stuff like that. I mean, he's very capable of it. He's an amazing composer, so I don't really doubt that he'll do that. We do have a little bit of audio that we have played before. We do know a little bit of what it'll sound like, sort of. I mean, the few cues that we've heard so far. Let's see. This is basically what we've heard from Jurassic World, right? I like to call this one As the Fallen Kingdom Turns, right? I mean, it kind of works because it's as the Jurassic World turns, right? It's the same thing. It's got a bit of different information in there laid in. You can hear different, I don't know what that is, the cello or something, like plucking, boom, boom, boom. And you hear different notes in the background with like the trumpets and whatnot. And then it somberly goes down here and transitions into the Jurassic Park motif here that we've heard before. And it did this in Jurassic World. I talked all about these songs that were released on Twitter and other social medias from Bayona and Giacchino while they're in the studio recording. So this is all live recorded, but it's stuff we've heard before. Slightly different, obviously, but it's a new take on stuff that we've already heard from Jurassic World. So it just makes me wonder, like, how does it come into play? So that, I'm not too sure. I mean, we heard it previously as they're traversing the island and showing off the park. We were in a helicopter. We were with the kids as they're going to the park and all that stuff. So I don't know how it's going to be used. Maybe in a similar fashion? I mean, we saw Owen in a plane, but he was very sad looking. He didn't look happy really too much, so I don't feel like that would work. So maybe it's used somewhere else. We do have this is a very emotional piece, right? I mean, it's something that we've already heard before too. We heard this in the Visitor Center. This is a track that was unreleased. It's called Ye Old Visitor Center, and maybe I'm wondering, I don't know if we'll revisit the Visitor Center or not, but maybe we're going to go back into the Innovation Center. I mean, we saw it in the trailer, so maybe this could be Ye Old Innovation Center. You know, just kind of a play on the old track. Kind of, I don't know. I don't know if that works, though, because they're using this Jurassic Park theme here. Very slow. And I think this is the difference between this track and Ye Old Visitor Center. So let me see. I might be able to bring that one up too. But it's very, I think it's a bit slower than that one. Oh yeah. They'll get into it, trust me. I think. Coming up. Come on, guys. Play the notes. No, that's the thing. I forgot. It's unresolved. Oh. That like hurts me musically. Oh man, that, I don't know if you guys feel that, but like when I listen to music and it's like unresolved, there's no, you know, conclusion to that. Oh man, let's listen to that moment again, because going back here, you get that, let's play it again, a little bit farther. So there should be that continuation. Sorry, terrible singing, I know. But we don't get it. It's so unresolved, and it like, it just, I feel wrong. I feel like it needs to resolve. So that's kind of interesting. That's a very interesting part, because the stuff that happens musically pertains to what happens in the film. So going back, let me see if I can bring that up real quick. Ye Old Visitor Center. Here it is. So it is, I think it's a little bit into the song. Basically, the same thing happens. Right? It's pretty much identical. It's got the old theme again. But this one's much faster, a little bit, right? It's not as, like, half-timed as the other one was. And then we're gonna hear what I mean by this one resolves slightly. You know, it's still scary and ominous and creepy. You know, it's got that kind of vibe to it, but it resolves right here. See? Doesn't that feel better? My God, that feels so much better. Just, you know what comes next. And when they didn't play it, it just felt wrong. And I'm not saying, like, they did a bad job. I'm just saying, like, that's musically, like, the thematic element that they're trying to put into that movie is that it's unresolved or something like that. So that's certainly emotional, and I just went on a really long tangent about that. But that's what I mean. I mean, it's emotional. So I wonder how that's going to play into the new movie. And then we have this new track, which is brand new. Ooh, loud. Remember our guys, I talked about, it really sounds like the end, or what part is that? Go back here, let's listen to that. I'm going to try to compare this. I don't have this stuff all up at the moment. I'm kind of doing this on the fly, so let's listen to this again. All right, so remember that, because I want to bring it up. I have a different version of the score here. Let's see if I can... I think it's in this one. It should be. So in this part in Jurassic World, you know, Claire is going to get the Rex and all that. And she's running, and she's got the flare in her hand, and it's all slow motion. She's got the heels, thankfully. And eventually the Rex kind of smashes through the Spinosaurus skeleton. And this is what happens. So let's see if we can compare this. I want to see if it actually sounds like it. Right here, ready? This is what I'm getting from that moment at the beginning of this, right here. Right? Let's see if I'm crazy. Let's go back here. Doesn't it sound very similar? Go back again. It has that triumph So something good happens, and then it comes down. So I wonder how that relates. But the other one's still playing in the background, so let's listen to this. Interesting. Man, I don't know. It doesn't really feel like it relates to much of anything. Bum, bum, bum. Ah, I don't know. I do get slight, I don't know, even want to really say it too much, but slight, like, Lost World vibes. But I don't even know if I can compare it to that at all. Not really. I don't know. It sounds new, and it sounds like a cliffhanger, right? That's what I was talking about before. We get this very cliffhangery moment, and especially because they said something like, in the tweet, that it was like, what a way to end the movie. Just like this. So, yeah, I mean, it sounds very cliffhangery. And the part before that, a lot of people have been kind of, I guess, comparing to Jaws. I don't know. I don't really think so, per se. I mean, we can take a listen to Jaws and see what we hear there. Oh, we got an ad here. Let's skip that. But I get why people are saying that. So maybe there is something to it. See, Jaws is very distinct, though, in that the beginning part. Obviously, it's just this part. It's very distinct with its dun-dun, dun-dun, dun-dun. It's just two notes, right? This one is not as distinct. I actually think it's more so one note in the background that's going, boom, boom. Excuse my terrible recreations, but that's what I think it's doing. With like a clarinet or something on top of it going, brr-lum. Very, very great recreation, wasn't it? Didn't I sound spot on? So I don't really feel like it sounds too much like this. Sort of, but I think it could be invoking the same thing. Because what is this theme used for? They use this whenever the shark is around. Whenever the shark's about to attack and you know it's there, but you're not necessarily seeing it. So I feel like that could be what's going to happen here. You know a dinosaur is around and you know it's coming, but you don't necessarily see it or something like that. I don't know. But if something along those lines happens and it's getting faster, just like it does with Jaws, you know? And then something happens here. Oh, something really dissonant. Man, sounds really messed up there. Like something bad, something really nasty. So I don't know. If that is a cliffhanger, it doesn't sound too good to me. Like it doesn't sound like a good ending. It sounds kind of scary. Yeah, that's what I got for you guys today. I don't know. I hope I answered all your questions correctly or up to your hopes there, Fede. And I loved it, man. I was not annoyed. I don't think anybody else was annoyed. You brought up some great points and some great questions there. So, Fede, keep sending stuff in, and we're going to keep trying to get you on here because it's worth it, because you brought up some great stuff. I hope you guys enjoyed this special one for Thursday. I don't usually get to do all these bonus episodes on Thursdays all the time, but since we're doing them, I might as well throw one in here and there. And I did not expect it to be 50 minutes, but it is. So I just talked on the fly for 50 minutes. There we go. Good job. Thank you. I'm congratulating myself now. I really feel like Ian Malcolm. This is perfect. But guys, go to our website, JurassicParkPodcast.com. Find all our stuff on there. Subscribe to our YouTube channel, which we've been doing a lot of stuff over there from the toy line. We've been going out on toy hunts, looking at stuffs in the stuffs. That's not a word. Stuff in the boxes. We're going to be unwrapping them and unboxing them all pretty soon. So stay tuned for that. Hopefully maybe even some more toy hunts. And as we're getting closer to the official release of these toys, I don't know when you're listening to this, but April 16th is the official date, the official street date. So head out to all your Targets and Walmarts and all that stuff. We're going to be doing the same. It's going to be a really fun time. Hopefully these stores are stocked well, because right now it's been up in the air. Nobody really knows. Some stores have it, some stores don't. But April 16th is the official date. So like I said, keep checking our YouTube, subscribe to our podcast on iTunes, Google Play, all those places where you can find your podcasts on your phone, your computer, wherever. And guys, thank you so much for listening to this episode. It's been great. Enjoy.
Are you hearing this?
Make sure to visit JurassicParkPodcast.com to find all our past episodes, brand new news articles, information on how to contact us, and much more. It's a great source for everything related to the podcast and, of course, Jurassic Park and Jurassic World. Head to JurassicParkPodcast.com and help us build a great community.
Anybody hear that?
Five minutes. Drop what you're doing and leave now.